Good morning and welcome to St. Paul's Church for our worship service on this Sunday morning, March 21st. We're so delighted you're here with us today worshiping, and we're especially delighted to worship our own bishop, Bishop DeDe Duncan-Probe. She'll be leading our service this morning, and we're so glad she's with us. I know many of you are joining us via the live stream. Others are on the Zoom meeting. Just a reminder that if you are joining us via Zoom, to keep your microphone muted unless it's time for your participation. Now enter into a time of worship with our opening hymn, hymn 439, What Wondrous Love Is This?
Love is this, O my soul, O my soul, what wondrous love is this, O my soul, what wondrous love is this that caused the Lord of bliss to lay aside his crown for my soul, to lay aside his crown for my soul. To God and to the Lamb I will sing, to God and to the Lamb I will sing. To God and to the Lamb who is the great I am. 1,000,000 join the theme, I will sing, while millions join the theme, I will sing. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing on, and when from death I'm free, I'll sing on. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing and joyful be, and through eternity, I'll sing on, and through eternity, I'll sing on.
Blessed be the God of our salvation,
who bears our burdens and forgives our sins.
Almighty God, you alone can bring into order the unruly wills and affections of sinners. Grant your people grace to love what you command and desire what you promise, that among the swift and varied changes of the world, our hearts may surely there be fixed where true joys are to be found. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our Old Testament reading is from Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more.
Let us read Psalm 119, 9 through 16 together. How shall a young man cleanse his way? By keeping to your words. With my whole heart I seek you. Let me not stray from your commandments. I treasure your promise in my heart, that I may not sin against you. Blessed are you, O Lord, instruct me in your statutes. With my lips, I will recite all the judgments of your mouth. I have taken greater delight in the way of your decrees than in all manner of riches. I will meditate on your commandments and give attention to your ways. My delight is in your statutes. I will not forget your word.
The second reading is from Hebrews. Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, you are my son, today I have begotten you. As he says also in another place, you are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest, according to the order of Melchizedek.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, sir, we wish to see Jesus. Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled. And what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered, this voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The Gospel of the Lord.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Come, Holy Spirit, speak to us. Give us ears to hear you and courageous hearts to follow where you lead. Amen. It is wonderful to be with you. Good morning. I am so glad to have this opportunity to gather, especially in this significant time, both in our world and in our lives together as people of faith. This is a time I think we can all see where we have been through much. This last year, as we celebrate this anniversary of a year that we did not anticipate and I think still did not really want. A year when people have died and suffered and been isolated, when we've found the real value of a casual lunch with a friend, when we've learned more deeply the value of gathering with family and friends around holidays. It's been a year of so many emotions, and there have been some beautiful things that have happened this year, some opportunities that might not have been revealed if it hadn't been for the starkness and scarcity around. But in all of this, the thing that has been certain and sure has been God's faithfulness in our midst. At no point in this year have we been truly alone, for the Holy Spirit has been moving within each of our lives. And so we hold all that has been before God in this time of Lent and lament with sorrow the places of brokenness and loss, pain and human frailty. And we hold before God our hopes, our desire for resurrection, our desire for newness, and yes, our desire for sunlight and spring, to hear the birds singing, to see grass peeking through the snow and to be revealed. This time when new life is coming, there's a hope that just maybe the winter and the hardness is passing. So many have talked about, oh, I wish it could go back to normal. And we all know when we say that, well, you know, what was normal and what was that about? And we can get very philosophical about normal. We can really have a good throwdown about that. But I wonder if we aren't feeling a desire for resurrection because we don't want normal. We want new. We want a world where a person's skin color, ethical identity, or personal understanding of who they are as a being of God is not denigrated and dehumanized. Because in this year, not only have we suffered the pandemic of COVID-19, we've suffered a pandemic of rising conspiracies and the continuation, not a new thing, but the continuation of the institutional racism in America continuing to be revealed and known. Even this week in Atlanta, I'm amazed to see people already try to dismiss what happened as something other than racism, as something other than the dehumanization of people because of who they innately have been created by God to be. It may be true that there are other contributing things, but what drives it is racism, pure and broken. So in this season of lamentation of Lent, lamenting racism as it is, and those of us with privilege not getting caught up in our own guilt or only, oh, I wish it weren't this way, or I had nothing to do with that, and all of those things we try to tell ourselves to soothe ourselves, to instead sit with the racism and recognize the horror of it, and then commit ourselves in each aspect of our lives to living differently. It was interesting on Facebook, you may have seen, since some of you are on Facebook Live or on YouTube Live, you're on YouTube Live. On Facebook, I posted about our book club we've been reading, and I hope you've had a chance to read Waking Up White since I'm sitting at home. This is one of the, you know, I have visual aids that I might not have if I were sitting in your beautiful sanctuary. But Waking Up White by Debbie Irving has been our book club book, and we're reading it. And next week we'll gather as a diocese and have conversation about it. It's a wonderful book. And I posted that on my Facebook page, and someone came right along behind it, a white person, privilege, and said, oh, well, that's a good entry-level book, but you should read this one too. And I wanted to respond and say, do you know that attitude is the very core, that's at the core of racism, being right, thinking we know, thinking our perspective is a little bit superior to someone else's, being very puffed up in our identity and our understanding, lacking humility. We've also on Facebook Live been reading Joan Chittister's book, Wisdom Distilled from the Daily, and talking about what real humility is, that there are actually 12 stages or steps to humility that we must go through in order to truly have a humble heart. And we begin with an understanding that God is God. And then we understand that because God is God, in each circumstance I find myself, I can find God. And I'm at peace with the moment because I know God. And the stages go on, but at stage 7, which is much like today's reading, stage 7 is about knowing who we are, that we are not perfect, and that we need God's salvation, and that we long for it. And so those who love their lives lose it. We offer it up as a gift, a pouring out, that God may heal us and renew us and make us new. And so our hope then, out of that lamentation of sorrow, becomes a hope for new life, where our life is poured out by God and has meaning and value and purpose. So with humility, we relate to the world, not with I'm right, or you need to know, or let me fix this, or well, I've already done that work. But we relate every day with, here, Lord, am I, send me. Here, Lord, am I, heal me. Here, Lord, am I, may my words today, may my actions speak of your grace and glory to the world. May I be part of healing, renewal, and hope. I remember when I was in college, I had a time where there was a lot going on, and I thought I was very sad because I was reading. It was one of the first times I had read Letters from a Birmingham Jail by the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And I lamented that I was not able to be at Selma, that I was not able to take part in some of those movements. And it would be a number of years before I would realize that each day we take part in walking across the Pettus Bridge, that each day we have an opportunity to be part of a movement of peace and hope and reconciliation and healing. How we spend our money, where we go, the people with whom we live and move, our attitudes about news, our willingness to learn, our willingness to be uncomfortable, to get comfortable, in fact, with discomfort. That the ways the gospel is calling us to be as people is to be actively engaged in living our lives in such a way that it is not about our holding on to or our having something, but about our offering something, our becoming something, our renewal into something. God is at work in you. Each of us, whether we are able to leave our house or not, the Holy Spirit hasn't quit calling us and nudging us and encouraging us and healing us in this sacred work of being the tapestry or the kingdom of God. Each of us a thread in that tapestry with purpose and meaning and value. Isolated or engaged, we all have a part to play. And I've known some people this last year who haven't left their house, haven't been able to do anything outside of their walls of their residence, and yet have touched the hearts of thousands of people in their giving, in their phone calling, in their emailing, in their participation in websites and Zooms like this one, and YouTube lives like this one, who've connected with other people and been an agent for hope. And some of you have been that person this last year. Some of you have also been giving and helping and encouraging. And some of us have been learning our own hubris, learning those places where we have been part of a problem we didn't even know we were contributing to. And so on this fifth Sunday of Lent, as we begin to prepare our hearts to turn our focus very purposefully on the passion of Jesus Christ, are you holding your life or are you losing your life? Is your main concern your fear and your anxiety? Or is love and a trust and a reliance on God helping you to turn that anxiety into an energy where that is used for other people? And in that using your energy for other people, you are being healed and made new. I want to close with a poem that I read often. So forgive me if you've heard me read this poem, but I love it and I think it's important and I think it's good. So I don't apologize necessarily for reading it. Just bear with me. It is a Mary Oliver poem. And I'm sure you've heard it. You probably have. You may even have it cross-stitched on your wall. It's called When Death Comes. But what I love about this poem is the clarity it brings, like this last year to us, because you can't face death without realizing the clarity of what living means. I appreciate about this poem how it brings into relief what is our desire for our life? What kind of normal are you hoping to create? What is it that you're hoping to return to? And what is it you're hoping to be transformed by? Mary Oliver writes this. When death comes like the hungry bear in autumn, when death comes and takes all the bright coins from his purse to buy me and snaps the purse shut. When death comes like the measles pox, when death comes like an iceberg between the shoulder blades, I want to step through the door full of curiosity, wondering, what is it going to be like, that cottage of darkness? And therefore, I look upon everything as a brotherhood and a sisterhood. And I look upon time as no more than an idea. And I consider eternity as another possibility. And I think of each flower, each life as a flower, as common as a field daisy and as singular. And each name a comfortable music in the mouth, tending, as all music does, towards silence. And each body a lion of courage and something precious to the earth. When it's over, I want to say all my life, I was a bride married to amazement. I was the bridegroom taking the world into my arms. When it's over, I don't want to wonder if I have made of my life something particular and real. I don't want to find myself sighing and frightened or full of argument. I don't want to end up simply having visited this world. Amen. Let us say together the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit. He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We turn to the prayers of the people. Great Creator of the worlds, we give you thanks for the many blessings of our lives. We give thanks for your wisdom given to us in Holy Scripture. We give thanks for the ability to be creative, for intelligence, and the ability to know right from wrong. We give thanks especially for the privilege of worshiping together today. As we journey through the wilderness, we walk with you, O God. Spirit of wisdom and truth, we pray for your guidance in our lives this day. We pray for teachers, scientists, and all who work for greater understanding. We pray for the strengthening of children, adults, and our communities in knowledge and understanding. As we journey through the wilderness,
we walk with you, O God.
Jesus, our brother, you lead us in the way of healing and love. We pray the divisions of our communities and our nation would be healed. We pray for healing and strength for those in need, especially Paul, Kathleen, Chris, Barbara and Bill, Linda, Pat, Marilyn, Jessica, Sherry, Harriet, David and Donna, Sally, Kevin, Leo, Deb, Victoria, Gary, Susan, Fran, Sue, Jim, Joan, Sherry, Cynthia, the Reverend Barbara Allen, all who struggle with depression and anxiety brought on by the COVID crisis, and all those living alone. As we journey through the wilderness,
we walk with you, O God.
Father, Mother God, you know our inmost thoughts and needs. As you have been with us from the beginning, be near us in the middle and at the end of our lives. We pray for our loved ones who have died, especially Eleanor Tuttle. As we journey through the wilderness,
we walk with you, O God.
God of the present moment, God who in Jesus stills the storm and soothes the frantic heart, bring hope and courage to all who wait or work in uncertainty. Bring hope that you will make them the equal of whatever lies ahead. Bring them courage to endure what cannot be avoided, for your will is health and wholeness. You are God, and we need you. Amen.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins for our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Also with you. Peace.
Peace, everyone.
Peace.
Good morning and welcome to St. Paul's Church. This morning, we're delighted to have Bishop DeDe Duncan-Probe with us as our officiant. Please join Bishop DeDe for our coffee hour at 10:30 this morning. It's 10:30 this morning on our Zoom coffee hour link. You can find that at St. Paul's homepage. Please join us for coffee hour at 10:30. You are invited to make an offering to the Bishop's Discretionary Fund. That donation site can be found at the diocesan webpage at cnyepiscopal.org, or it could be mailed to the diocese. And that information is also on the diocesan webpage and also on today's service sheet. So we invite you to contribute generously to the Bishop's Discretionary Fund. Very big thank you to all those who helped make this service possible today, especially to our singer, to Gerard, to our technical engineer, Mark, to the Bishop's assistant, Meredith Sanderson, and everyone else who participated in today's service, DJ Eigelsrud and Darina Samuels, who served as our lectors this morning. Thank you. I want to let you know that the next couple days are the last days to get in your requests for memorials for Easter flowers. You can let us know about your requests for Easter flowers either by calling Beverly Bolton at her home or by calling the church office on Tuesday. On Tuesday, we'll have the church office phones open, and you're invited to call us and let us know about your requests for Easter flowers at that time. I want to let you know that our next edition, the April 1st edition of The Courier, will be published later on this week. So please look for information about The Courier with lots of important announcements. And one of those announcements is about our Holy Week services. Our Holy Week services are, we really have a full schedule of Holy Week services, and you can find that announcement in the April 1st edition of The Courier. We're really looking forward to being back to our regular schedule of 8 and 10 a.m. worship services that will begin on Easter Sunday, April 4th. Again, there's more information about that in the Courier, but we look forward to seeing you either on the live stream or in person for those 8 and 10 a.m. worship services. Please join with me in our closing hymn. It's hymn 599. Hymn 599, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Is in the name of the Lord,
the maker of heaven and earth.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
From this time forth, forevermore.
The blessing, mercy, and grace of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.